The Toxic Meritocracy of Video Games from 2018 is a book by Christopher Paul and applies a rhetorical analysis on toxic circumstances and attitudes in the video game industry and gamer culture. Paul investigates the interrelation between a meritocratic system present in video game industry, game design, and subsequently gamer culture, and toxic language and behavior that are a result of this meritocracy. The idea of meritocracy generally concerns social order and how to allocate resources. Backers of meritocratic norms typically believe that skills should be measured, that effort should be tracked, and that those who demonstrate the best combinations of talent and hard work should rise to the top of the social ladder. The problems that Paul sees in a system where merit determines social dynamics are on one hand the structural inequalities and on the other solidifying aristocracies. He traces these issues in the video game industry where until recently most developers consisted of white male developers from middle-class backgrounds. Structural inequalities are inherent even though the video game industry claims to be an open, meritocratic system where the best people are hired. Yet, according to Paul, the current staff of many developers show that gender and racially diverse teams are seldom, which shows that especially women and minorities seem to have not the same chances. Yet, while stats show more women and minorities in engineering and technical education programs, the video game industry remains exclusive as it has turned from a meritocracy to aristocracy. So a club of an insular social demographic is in charge of industry norms and practice, and controls and employs workforce according to their ideals. Therefore, even if diverse workforce on the market should be meritocratically drafted according to the best of the best, an aristocratic core ideology still favors a specific demographic. Paul concludes that these aspects are embedded in how games are produced, which meaning they create, and ultimately, which kind of video game culture they foster. We rarely think through how the interrelationships among designers, players, journalists, and academics mean that games are often targeted to an insular community with relatively consistent expectations and standards. As the balance of resources tilts, expertise and success in video games is based less on merit and more on the inheritance of structures that let certain players circumvent examinations of ability or skill. Therefore, evaluating all by merit and referring to an insular pool of people, in short white males, creates, according to Paul, an exclusive and homogeneous culture that acts in toxic behavior and language. Multiplayer games such as League of Legends, Overwatch, Call of Duty, or Counter-Strike are products of a meritocratic game design that targets an audience that is already skillful in these games and ranks them according to their skill, creating a community that is racist, sexist, and offensive. Through rhetoric analysis, Paul identifies that common language used in multiplayer online games include toxic language that offends players in ways and where their skill is said to be that of a girl, disabled, or black person. Because all is measured by merit, players utilize a vocabulary to stigmatize and exclude certain demographics to claim and present their status of being real gamers. Something that echoed in the Gamergate movement, a movement which was a conservative reaction to questionable relations between game journalism and game developers in setting up agendas that did not align to the opinion of a vast amount of the gamers. The reaction was further harassment and hate speech. Anyhow, Paul continues to show how the idea of meritocracy produces toxic communities with incestuous expectations of how game design should be, which representations they should use, and which stories should be told. These expectations are then in a feedback loop forwarded to the gaming industry that produces, according to these expectations, more of the same intellectual property that is recycled over and over. hardening expectations and making players less likely willing to try out different games that are not primarily based on skill, fighting, killing, and competition. Paul argues that the industry needs to free itself from this toxic cycle. It needs to be more diverse and inclusive within its ranks of developers and needs to risk experimenting on new game design to help to create new and less toxic communities. Games like Journey, Mountain, or Gone Home, games that capitalize on creative cooperation between players or new ways of storytelling that engage players without skill systems or leaderboards. On the last page, Paul concludes, "The hate, the lack of understanding, the feelings of superiority, all these elements are tightly linked to symbol systems related to merit and earning one's advancements. It is often the systems and structures that need to be addressed, as changing problematic norms is a key factor in addressing troublesome communities." I do definitely agree with many perspectives in the book. I do agree that multiplayer gaming culture should become less toxic, as I have my own experience with that, League of Legends or Battlefield, Call of Duty, being toxic myself at certain times. I also agree with the fact that the industry must become more diverse to be able to create novel and innovative experiences. Yet there are many factors I do disagree with Paul's book and his claims. Number one being especially that the excessive generalizations that are done in the book. So first of all, it is very regressive in my perspective how Paul generalizes the whole video game culture under the term gamer culture. Like, if all people or all gamers or video gamers are playing the same games, having the same opinions, and this is absolutely not representative in the way how he dealt with it. From my experience, but also from other studies, it is obvious that the gaming culture is much more stratified, different in many ways, and especially concerning the Gamergate thing, that was something that was, well, it was terrible, but nevertheless, the amount of players that interacted in that movement do not represent and did not represent the vast majority of players who were more or less unimpressed by that. Coming to the other generalization Paul does in the book is that he refers to gaming culture as something very American, though me coming from Germany, I had completely different experiences. For example, things like Gamergate movement didn't affect anyone. Like, I remember when that happened many years ago, or I mean, it's still going on in a way. People are more or less ignorant towards those things here in Europe, at least from my perspective, and this is something taking place mostly on the American stage. Also, video game cultures on a national basis. I lived in Poland, I'm currently living in Austria, and I lived in Germany. So their video game culture is absolutely different, works differently, and is in one way or another, or in certain aspects more toxic or less toxic. So anyhow, trying to assess the whole gaming culture as being toxic and regressive is something that I consider regressive itself, so something I profoundly disagree with Paul in that matter. Another aspect I found a bit troubling was that Paul tries to blame the toxicity game solely on the game design. I do think that this has a lot to do with the toxicity emerging, so I do believe that there is some truth to the competitiveness that creates toxicity, but I also believe that it, with saying or with delegating the problem to the game design, Paul actually takes the autonomy away from the player being responsible for his own behavior online. And this is something I think is a problematic thing. So I think players should be more responsible with their behavior. But on the other side, especially being online, and if people want to just have some, well, creative regression in their free time, it is okay to not act according to certain norms. Of course, there are extremes, but I do not agree that the game design is solely responsible for the toxicity. There are a lot of players with different motivations. There are trolls on the internet. There are people who are taking games seriously, like in RPGs. And there are players with an aggressive potential that they can't temper. And this has but mostly to do with the characters of the real players themselves. So maybe educating players about being good losers and fair winners would be maybe a more progressive approach to addressing toxicity in gaming culture, instead of just saying that that competitive game design or skill-based game design is the main purpose for toxic gaming culture. However, I do think that the toxic meritocracy of video games and why gaming culture is the worst is a fair read, and I do definitely recommend taking a look at it. It has very valuable perspectives, it is very well written, and even if you don't agree with most of the perspectives, which is totally fine, you can still get a very overarching and very well-grounded perspective on why gaming culture is the worst. Thank you for listening.